the unauthorized copy, dedicated to the greatest. My name's Sean Boone. Chapter 3. Born Cassius Clay Jr., January 17th at 42, Louisville, Kentucky, he grew up. A little boy doing what a little boy do, till somebody stole his bike. Swearing up and down they would pay the price. A police officer overheard, laughed at the child and he gave advice. Told him to take that rage to fight, come to my gym and train to fight. Little did he know that would change his life, make him a star, put his name in lights. As an amateur, he would bandage up anyone he faced. Through the hands, to the ledge, even then he knew the kid was destined to be great. Golden child, hey, golden gloves on the road to Olympic gold. In Rome, everything he dreamed, got his ticket, then his feet got cold. Rain in the eyes on the way to the fight, he made it. And in that 1960 Olympics victory, he declared himself the greatest. Critics watched his frown and his boxing style, said he couldn't keep his guard up. He went pro and it still couldn't knock him down. Hands low, damn, he can dance, so made him look too stiff to box. A punch too quick to clock, you get hit before you get front tick to tock. And by 64, he was giving knockout predictions. What round, it would hit the floor, ridiculing his opposition. Dismissed as a Louisville lip, outspoken but never outboxed. Listed finally gave in, and Clay got his first title shot. He even put out an album, threw a few sunny poems together, and called it I Am the Greatest. Some say the first battle rap ever. He said he knocked him out in 8, but nobody believed, nobody listened. Till the headlines came, Cassius Clay beat Sonny Liston. And after that, huge upset, he upset the world. When he announced he was a member of the Nation of Islam, he lashed back like, what was it I did wrong, huh? And in the fashion of Malcolm X, fool me, had profound respect. From his slave name, he said, I'm free. Then he became young Muhammad Ali. Then the love for him got outweighed by outrage and fear of his new devout faith to an organization perceived as only being about hate. Years later, he refused to draft, denounced the war on the grounds of religious beliefs. And they hated him more, they told him to go to jail or go to Vietnam. And they took his title and his boxing license, so we took it to court for 3 years long. And somewhere in that time, America realized the war was wrong. And he went from traitor to hero, and in a year or so, he was coming back strong. Moving with such grace and ease, flow like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Hand can't hit what your eye can't see. Then came the fight of the century. Ali, Joe Frazier, Vaz matchups, there were no greater. First professional loss, but he will beat him in a rematch later. But by then, Frazier lost the belt to a man by the name George Foreman, much stronger and younger than Ali. Still he said, I'm in if you're in. Then came the rumble in the jungle, promoted by Don King. 74, they went to Zaire. You gotta go play like, what do I hear? They were saying, Ali, Ali, first. His victory made history, but it was more than just being the best. It was character, it was charisma, being someone that cares for us. You see, he redefined the word champion to a category that the rest can't be in. Unauthorized biography of Muhammad Ali. Epilogue. The next 7 years of his legendary boxing career were not without its price. And in the early 80s, he would go on to develop Parkinson's disease, presumably due to all the punishment he had endured. But that didn't stop Ali from what he calls his true life calling and humanitarian endeavors. Traveling around the world as the goodwill ambassador to us all. Next chapter. Martin Luther King Jr.